Now that you have an idea about classification, you have an idea about the history of classification, how this entire field of study has developed over a period of time in the recent centuries. Now we are going to get into what has been developed, that is, what is the basic criteria or what are the basics of classification. What we are going to study next is basically taxonomy, and our prime focus would be on nomenclature, where we are going to study about the binomial nomenclature. As you are aware that this nomenclature thing was given by Carolus Linnaeus, the binomial nomenclature, so we are going to study about that, and we are going to get an idea what is identification and how step by step we do the process of classification, and entire thing is under the systematics field of biology. Now, first of all, you need to learn by heart is the definition of taxonomy. Now, taxonomy is the branch of science that deals in study of what? It is the study of principles and procedures of biological classification. Now, this is the important point, and this has to be remembered as it is, that this branch of biology under systematics, it deals with the principles, those principles according to which an organism would be classified under a particular taxon. This we have discussed earlier as well, but now we are going to see it from the point of view of the actual definition that we write whenever asked, or we tell, and this is the learning definition, I must say that. The study of principles and procedures of the biological classification, and what are the fundamental elements of that classification, or we can say that this branch, what the fundamental elements on which this branch is based on is the element of nomenclature, then we have classification, and then we have identification. Now you need to understand these three fundamental elements. First one is nomenclature. That is, if you have seen an organism and you have studied over that organism, studied about that organism, and you're going to publish about that organism supposedly, it has to be given a proper name according to the universal rules that have been set by certain organizations. We're going to understand what those organizations are and how do they put rules according to which the nomenclature is to be done. So nomenclature is naming the organism, all right? Then it is, after it has been named and identified properly, not identified, identification is done later on, but once it has been named, it is to be classified in the particular taxon, all right? According to the classification that we do, and there are certain taxons, there is a hierarchical order that is being followed, and over there we have kingdom, then we have phylum, then we have classes. We are going to get to that. Kingdom, phylum, classes, then there is order, and in the end we have species. Now I would try to remember, make you recall who gave the term species. I hope you remember it. If you have seen the previous lesson, it was given by John Ray. So the species level is the lowermost level in this classification criteria. So once the organism has been named, it is to be classified in the particular taxon, and once the classification has been done in the given taxon, identification is to be made that the given organism, suppose you have given organism named as A, so this organism would be belonging to some other. If not belonging to some other, it would be having some sort of resemblance to other organisms which are already classified. So there is an identification that is to be made with pre-existing organisms according to their taxon, so that the organism fits in a better way in the classification criteria. I hope I am clear that once supposedly you see something like a snake, but for now you are not keeping it identification criteria, you see an organism that is new to you and that that is resembling somewhat like a snake. So first of all you give it a name according to the rules. Now the rules will be discussed in a while, and then there is a classification that is made that this would be the species, this would be the genus, and it would belong to this animalia or whatever the conditions are. The classification could be made easily and in a better way if an identification is made with already pre-existing organisms. Now as I told you that it resembles a snake, for that you need to identify with the snakes already, and those snakes already are present in some classification taxonomical hierarchy. So that is what is the fundamental about this entire study. These are the fundamental studies or the fundamental criterias or elements according to which taxonomy runs. Now, coming to our main topic for this lesson, that is nomenclature, we're going to study how this nomenclature has evolved. First of all, in the beginning, it was the polynomial nomenclature which was practiced, and do pay attention to the terms. As I tell you, that inside each term there is a meaning which is hidden, you need to break it. Polynomial, from your knowledge of mathematics, you might be knowing something which is more than two. So the polynomial nomenclature was practiced before 1750s, and all the systematics practitioners, whatever the nomenclature practice was included during that time before 1750s, it was in such a way that the name of the particular organism, it could be a plant, it could be an animal, it could be a protistan, that particular organism, there it was named, and there were certain mentioning words which were given. Now, supposedly you are talking about a plant and it is having some sort of inflorescence. So, in the name, the inflorescence would be mentioned as well. So, the polynomial nomenclature had many words in it, not two, not three, it could be four, it could be five. So, there were specific words which mentioned the particular characteristics of the organism, and it was practiced before 1750s. Later in 1758, there came the binomial nomenclature. Now, this one is the nomenclature that is practiced even today, and this is the nomenclature that you usually see in your books mentioned. It was in 1758 given by Carolus Linnaeus. Now, this is a sort of revision of your historical knowledge of classification. We had done history of classification. Carolus Linnaeus in 1758 gave the binomial nomenclature, in which there is mention of two words. Binomial refers, you might have done binomial equation in your math study. Over there you have two variables basically. Here over you're going to find two words in the name, and first word in the binomial nomenclature is the genus, and the second one refers to the species of the organism. So there are two words. Alright, two words that would be equivalent to the scientific name. It is commonly known as the scientific name. Now, why do we need nomenclature? Coming to this, why do we need scientific name? The reason for scientific name is that our earth is not a small place. There are many regions, and the organisms are widespread, all thanks to evolution and the different geological developments that took place in the history of earth. All thanks to that, we have diverse life forms which are spread over many places. Now, because we are dealing with the things that humans have to understand about the other life forms, humans have different languages in different regions. So, one organism can have many names in different regions. You can just take any example, supposedly. Take any example of a common pet or something. It would be called by a different name in one region. In India itself, you can make it out. In our country itself, it would be different. In other country, it would be totally different. And the name and the reference would be for one organism itself, but the names would be many. So, in order to avoid that confusion, what has been considered is that the organism has a scientific name which is universal, which means whether you go to one corner of the world or the other corner of the world, according to the reference, that particular organism is going to have single name, and it would be easier for those who have to study by that name, and they will not be confused by the various names. So, those various names which vary from one place to another, according to the common tongue, that those names are known as vernacular names. So, in order to avoid the confusion by vernacular names which could arise in study of a particular organism, these names were nulled, and they are used though, they were nulled, and a scientific nomenclature was kept in place of these vernacular names, and we arrived at the scientific name. The person who gave this binomial nomenclature was Carolus Linnaeus, and it was quite easy for us to identify the organism by the genus and species. Now, genus could be similar, but the species is going to be different, and every organism is going to have its unique scientific name. Thanks to that, unique but universal. Thanks to that, it is easier for those who have to study a particular organism or its characteristics, and we can say that those who practice systematics, it is good for them and it is easier for them to identify an organism, all thanks to this scientific name. Now, this scientific name had to be unique. It should not change with time. That is why it was considered that we should use a language that is dead. And Latin is a language which is a dead language. Now, why do we call Latin as a dead language? Because Latin is not spoken anymore. So, when you have a language that is being spoken, there is addition of words every year. Like, I would give you an example of the word selfie that has been added recently to English. Now, English is an ever-changing language. Why it is changing? Because there are addition of words. The words get changed, they get replaced. But if the language is dead, there won't be any addition. Whatever word has been practiced earlier, it would not be changed. So that is why Latin has been taken, and Latin words are used for this genus and species. Now, there are certain rules for this binomial nomenclature. We are going to come to that. We will come to that very soon. But for now, I would give you an example of mango, because according to Carolus Linnaeus, the example that was given by him was mango itself. Now, if I talk about mango, there are many names for mango. You go to any region, there would be a different name for that. But the scientific name for mango spoken over here, you go to South America, you would find that similar name that would be over there in books of those who study this science. It would be Mangifera indica. Now, in this name, we are going to see the rules of binomial nomenclature. The first word of the name of the organism has to be capital. The first alphabet of the first word would be capital letter, while the second letter would have its alphabet that would be small, low, uppercase and lowercase. This you have to remember. Secondly, if it is written, if it is printed, it should be in italics specifically. But in case if it is not printed, like I am writing it, it needs to be underlined individually. There should be a different underline for the genus word, while a different underline for the specific word. This is used as, this one is called generic epithet and this one is called specific epithet. So the specific epithet as well as the generic epithet, they need to be underlined separately. And if it is not to be underlined, if it is written in italics, you need not to underline it. If it is not written in italics, there has to be a line which should come there. The first alphabet of the first word should be capital. The second one should not be capital. And the genus and species name should not, it should be in Latin. It should not be considering what an organism is like. There should not be the condition of resemblance of the organism with the Latin meaning. It should be given as it is, and then it should be remembered by heart, and whosoever has done the nomenclature then can publish it in the book, and a new organism would be there to study. So this is about binomial nomenclature. In the binomial nomenclature, there is another thing, that whosoever gives the name, there is mention of that person. So supposedly there is this name is given by Linnaeus, so it would be Mangifera indica Linnaeus, the name of the scientist or the person who has given this name. There would be mention of its, his or her name as well. After this comes the trinomial nomenclature. Trinomial nomenclature or the binomial nomenclature, when trinomial nomenclature came, it did not discard the binomial one completely, because the trinomial one takes into account the subspecies as well. As our knowledge about the organisms is increasing, and as our classification criteria became phylogenetic one, and There were other classifications like hemotaxonomy, cladistics, and rest of the all. There was increase in the taxons, and the subspecies was one that came into being. And with that, there was a new nomenclature practice that is known as trinomial nomenclature, where we include generic epithet, then we have specific epithet, and then we have subspecies as well. I would give you an example. It is Homo sapiens sapiens. Now, considering ourselves, what is our specific name? It is Homo sapiens sapiens. Now, sapiens is species and sapiens is another subspecies, so that we have to consider. Last thing that we have to understand in this lecture is, it's not about understanding, it's just about learning that who gives these nomenclature, who sets these rules. So we have certain abbreviations, that is ICBN, that is International Code for Botanical Nomenclature. So you have to remember, IC stands for International Code, B stands for Botanical, N stands for Nomenclature. Now I'm going to change this third term and you're going to see what is the difference. ICZN, that is ICZN otherwise, this is Botanical. Z would stand for, Z or Z would stand for Zoological Nomenclature. Then we have another similar to this, that is International Code for Bacteriological Nomenclature, International Code for Viral Nomenclature, International Code for Nomenclature of Cultivated Plants. So these are the abbreviations that you have to remember. I'm going to repeat them. ICBN, that is International Code for Botanical Nomenclature, which would set the guidelines for naming the plants. Then we have International Code for Zoological Nomenclature, that would set the guidelines for naming the animals, whatever animals are considered. Now we have a five kingdom classification where we don't only have plants and animals, we do have bacteria as well. For that we have bacteriological. Remember, it would not be bacterial, it would be bacteriological. Okay, you might get confused, or you might write somewhere bacterial, you have to write bacteriological nomenclature. Then we have naming of viruses, that is done according to the guidelines which are set by International Code for Viral Nomenclature. And the last one is, we do have cultivated plants, where we consider variety. Variety of the plant is given an importance, because every university or every institution, whosoever is studying on different varieties, transgenic varieties, it gives rise to a new variety, and that is set according to International Code for Nomenclature of Cultivated Plants. Again, I'm repeating, it is the code for nomenclature of cultivated plants. Over here, it would not be in the end, the nomenclature is not in the end. We have nomenclature of cultivated plants. So this is all about nomenclature we have studied, and this is all about the basics of classification, according to which the classification is made, and nomenclature plays an important role. Next in the lesson, what we are going to study is, what are the various taxons that we need to be aware of in order to understand an organism's position in the classification hierarchy.